I enjoy the teachings of Jesus, especially in this book, because he handles the situation so well. He's both completely adamant, but also very understanding and kind in the way he presents it. Now, the teachers you want to look for are those who are adamant, which essentially say no exceptions, no exemptions, no exceptions, no exemptions, no exceptions, no exemptions. And they say, well, if you want to keep trying to make exemptions, you're free to do so. And you shouldn't feel bad about it or wrong about it. God supports that just as equally to everything else. But it's eventually you'll realize it's futile. There are no exceptions and exemptions. So here's what you need to do to drop this path of futility. So I'm trying to follow in as best as possible in the footsteps of Jesus in the way that he handles this issue. Where, you know, he is so good at handling the fact that most of us are going to say, ah, no way, we're going to keep trying for exceptions or exemptions. And you know, he just handles that very nicely. And always brings us back to, got to go beyond. You have to make that leap of faith. And that's what we're trying to do here. And we are working towards it in the fourth phase, where we are dropping most explanation, just dropping it and trying to make that leap, a leap of faith. Say, I do not know. I do not know. I do not know what I am. I do not know where I am. These are three very potent. I do not know. I do not know what I am. I do not know where I am. Or I do not know anything. I do not know anything. I do not know what I am. I do not know where I am. This is a powerful three-part chord that's, when struck, it resonates. Now the crowd, imagine the analogy for the world is, let's say there's a marathon route that has to be run. Everyone has to run this marathon. And when you finish the marathon, you're done with this world and with self-deception. There's a start line. And at the start line, everybody's stretching, limbering up, getting ready. And some start running the marathon, and they're off, and they've been running and for quite some time, maybe. And then along the marathon route, you'll see occasional few runners just plodding along, out of breath. It's tough, very difficult, but they're getting it done. Back at the finish line, the start line, all these people are still stretching, getting limber. And say, what are you doing? When are you going to start? Well, I'm just not limber yet, limber enough yet, Just got to get more limber. And say, well, why aren't you starting? Well, if I get more limber, it'll be easier, a lot easier. Oh, huh, okay. So you check back later at the start line, and there's some more folks have started, but a lot of runners haven't even started yet, and they're all still stretching. And there's like coaches there doing stretching coaches saying, okay, well, let me help you stretch out. And they're all doing all this stretching there at the start line. Okay. And you might say, hey, it's getting late. Don't you want to get started here? Oh, yeah. Just not quite limber enough yet. Just not quite limber enough yet. We're almost there. Almost there. Yeah, so there's classes there. There's everybody's teaching. Teachers are there. Students are there. How to get limber enough to start that marathon. You really got to, hold this pose. I'd hold this pose like this and say, as soon as I really master this, then I'll get going on the marathon. Meanwhile, the ones that started long ago, they're crossing the finish line. They're crossing the finish line. And they look back and they say, hey, where is everybody? And they're told they're all still at the start line. They haven't started yet. It's like, wow, what are they doing? Well, they're stretching, they're getting ready. Wow, that's not how you do it. You do it by starting and just plodding along. You're never going to do it by just saying that, oh, if I just get limber enough, it'll be a piece of cake. It's never going to be a piece of cake at all. So it's getting started that is the hardest part, for sure. This is where we delay the most. This is where the most intense delay is to prevent us from even getting started. We try not to start at all. Why? We're delaying. Why are we delaying this pretending I'm stretching, getting ready? We're waiting for an exemption, an exception. We're waiting to be here. Maybe we're an exception. God's made an exception for us. Or we're waiting to see if we've been able to earn an exemption from our loyalty to a deity or something like that. So they're just waiting for that exemption so they can say, oh, I'm lucky. I won the lottery. I don't have to do the race. Isn't that great? So everybody thinks, maybe I'm going to get lucky. Maybe I'm going to get lucky. Don't have to do that. And I can just spend my lifetime indulging my senses and I won't have to go through the ordeal of the marathon. Okay. So what is the preaching at the start line that has to take place? No exceptions, no exemptions, no exceptions. Pure, unequivocal, no exceptions, no exemptions. No residue, no explanation. Just no exceptions, no exemptions. Preaching that. People need to hear that. They need to hear it. Now, most will not start unless there's some really terrible suffering they run into in their lives. They will delay and delay, hoping to get lucky, get a lucky exception, earn some exemption by being loyal to someone who claims they can get them an exemption from God. They won't start. But when their lives just fall apart, then they realize, wow, I got my life is ruined. There's no reason, just might as well start. Nothing else to do. My life's shot anyway. So I might as well just go for it and hopefully I can be redeemed in some way. You know, this will end up in some redeeming experience that will make me, you know, not feel so bad about, you know, ruined life or something. And that's what usually gets us started. This is very standard. So, like in my case, my life just fell apart from the beginning, really, and just got worse and worse and worse, and it was just a complete nightmare from the get-go. My health just eventually, the stress was too much, my health just collapsed. I just fell through the cracks, and I realized my life is just ruined, shot life. It's not. I'm going to have a terrible life. And so I said, wow, my life's already ruined. There's no way I can, you know, Humpty Dumpty fell off the wall. And I said, I can't put it back together again. So I might as well see if I can get redemption in some way. And so I said, I just got to get started. There's nothing else to do. You just have to get started. And so I got started. And I've been running the marathon, you know, my whole life. And, you know, now seeing that, you know, finishing has to happen. Finishing has to happen. A leap of faith has to happen. A leap of faith has to happen where you say, I don't know what I am. I don't know where I am. I was reading this book, Journey Beyond Words, which in my opinion is straight from Jesus. And he said, say, I don't know what I am. Let me see if I can grab that quote. I don't know what I am. Yeah. Insofar as you can feel at that level, you shall realize the truth which I have just spoken. Your leap of faith is to come to the point when you say, I do not know. And that leap shall take you to your freedom. For when you say, I do not know, even to not knowing what you are, you automatically open to the experience of the oneself. So, he's talking about, I don't even know what I am. I do not know what I am. But he also is talking about here, for example, he says, it is one thing to say you are everywhere, but hear me well. To say that you are everywhere is predicated on a belief that a quote-unquote where exists. But for you as spirit, there is no quote-unquote where. There only is. There only is. So, really, we can all say, I do not know where I am. There's a very positive statement. Say, I do not know is an extremely positive statement. It's basically saying, I am spirit. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. Total freedom, total indeterminacy. So I do not know means thoughts, concepts which are relating to the belief in determinacy, belief in time, space, process, and form, and trying to delineate what I am from this belief in process and indeterminacy, meaning one moment has an influence on another, and this one has influence on the other, chain of concatenation, mental chain of causation. Believing in that, thoughts and concepts arise of West to what I am, some chain, in other words, some determinacy. There is no such I, no such determinacy. There is no mission, there is no purpose. God has not sent us on some determinate mission here. So to say I do not know means I do not know that at all. I do not know that at all. I do not know that. There's nothing to know in terms of an I. There isn't anything to know. I do not know. I do not know what I am, meaning I do not know that at all. I do not know what I am, because freedom is not a what I am. It's freedom is freedom. It's always free, so the self is not delineated by any experiencing, any determinate specific experiencing. So I do not know what I am. I do not know where I am. Okay, again, aware also is the term. I'm here as opposed to somewhere else. And even everywhereness is, we're even freer, beyond even that, freer than that. We cannot even say. So I do not know where I am. I do not know what I am. I do not know where I am. I do not know anything. I do not know what I am. I do not know where I am. This constitutes the leap of faith. Now, I had a dream last night that showed me this. It was an amazing dream. And the gist of it is, I realized that I saw this landscape, this realm. I saw the third dimensional realm, the fourth dimensional realm, I saw the fifth dimensional realm. I was right there in this triangle, right area, and I was almost able to step into the fifth dimension, the higher realm, so to speak. But I couldn't quite figure out how to do it. And I ended up falling back down into the third dimension or something like that. And I was trying to say, wow, it's very difficult to figure out how to do this. This is where a leap of faith is required. The leap of faith is required, which is to say, I do not know where I am. I do not know where I am. As long as we believe we know where we are, we cannot enter the realm of the higher realms of supernature. We cannot. One more. In order to enter into supernature, the death-free realm, the higher realm, the expression of our true nature, even having some form, some delineation of form still, we have to make what's called, Jesus says, a leap of faith. It cannot be done through concepts, through words, through thoughts, through ideas, through thinking at all. So you have to say, I do not know where I am. I do not know where I am. And when you can accept that positively, you'll realize you are, quote unquote, everywhere. You are the isness. Wherever you are is exactly where you've always been. Wherever you are is always, and will always be exactly where you've always been. And he says you will find yourself like as if shifting into your, shifting back home, finding yourself back home like that. So I was trying to figure out, like, where do I put my foot? And it was very difficult. Even though it was very close, I couldn't quite find a way to step into it. I could not find a way. It was really strange. The angles and everything, it didn't allow for any way to bridge it or step into it. Into this realm that I saw, oh, this is what I really want. The fourth dimension, no, this one, no. This one, no. This one, I look, I said, oh, wow. This, I want to be walking in there. I want to be walking along there. And it's very, very close. but I couldn't quite step. It seemed like I needed to leap, make a leap. There's some gully there that I was slipping. I tried to do it. I'd slip away and slide and slip. I couldn't do it. A leap is required. But what is this leap? This leap is a leap into nowhere, everywhere. I don't know this. I don't know this. I don't know. I don't know this. There's nothing to know. Isness does not need to know anything about isness. So we do have to practice this indeterminacy, continue to practice no explanation, just like, I do not know, full stop, I do not know, because we have to go beyond thinking, go beyond words, go beyond explanations. This much is very clear. You cannot, should never try to master it in terms of thinking you can give a lecture or talk to someone and explain it to them. Jesus talks about this in saying, let's see. Let me see if I can find this. Okay. Thirdly, do not try and sit and figure this out. Do not try and sit and reason it out with your thoughts. Do not try to understand it. Understand in such a way that you could lecture your fellow men and have them know. For in your thinking, you cannot know. And further, you cannot tell another. You cannot know. You cannot tell another. You cannot tell another. They too have to make the leap of faith. Everyone has to make this leap of faith. Now the marathon just gets us to the finish line, and we have to leap across the finish line. You cannot cross it. You have to leap across it, as it were. It's a leap of faith. So what we're aiming for is this leap of faith. This is what we aim for. Those who have actually gotten started on the running the marathon, most are not started yet. And they have all sorts of contests, who can be the most limber, who's doing the most effective limbering up routine, who has the best outfit, running outfit, who has the best running shoes, who seems like most likely to succeed, all this stuff they have at the start line, and just this huge entire world culture of talking about the start line and all this issues, and they forget all about starting the marathon. Really, the world forgets all about it. This is what we're coming into now, in a phase of this world where these unrepentant spirits in this world who are really hooked on technology and entertainment and all this stuff, they're like oblivious that you have to start the marathon. They're celebrating they're stretching, they're limbering up, they're celebrating being at the start line, and they've forgotten you're supposed to start. And the idea of starting is like, what? We got some board. We got a whole awards banquet here to run. Everybody's got to show up at the awards banquet. First place, second place, best costume, running costume, best this. We've got all these awards are given out, and if they start, they can't attend the awards ceremony. You're crazy. You can't even start. We're not finished with our with our awards show yet. And we got bands playing, of course, and said, yeah, we're pepping people up to run this race, and who's the best band, who's the best singer, all sorts of award shows of entertainment. And they said, no, we can't start, we gotta attend the award show. And these singers and entertainers, they have to be there, and you need to watch and do. And so you have an entire world culture designed to distract you from even starting. This is why this world culture is not a good world culture at all. It is possible in having a helpful culture that people are encouraged to start, actually, and they do. Whereas right now we have an entire world culture that is trying to dissuade anyone from starting, claiming that it's a super rude. I mean, how could you not attend a banquet in your honor. As soon as you're trying to get started, somebody just kind of jumps up and says, "Wait a minute, wait. I'm planning some big celebration in your honor. You got to attend that. You know, you can't get started yet. You got to attend. It'd be super rude. You're gonna let down all these people. Everybody's gonna be there to honor you for being someone who's really limbered up, really tremendously, and is wearing a nice outfit." And has nice things to say, and been singing some good songs and everything. So we wanna praise you, and everybody's gonna be there. You can't start. This is what happens, right? This is what happens. And you know, there's politicians there. They get elected to be, you know, head cheerleader, head banquet giver. Collect taxes for everybody. We need to build some big concert halls and stadium, and we got to build and all this stuff. And people want us to, you know, be into this. And of course, they all think, "Oh, we're totally into this marathon. We're totally into it. What are you talking about? Everybody's into it. We got this great culture that's totally into it. This is what's happening in the world. So everybody in this world thinks they're really into the marathon. Totally into it." They're totally into avoiding starting is what they're into, totally into. They have a million and one excuses, million and one ways to distract themselves. Well, some people are like painting a picture of the start line. Look at this. Others are photographing the start line. Some are taking video of the start. Look at this, all these people here. Wow, look at this big happening. You know, there's so many people here, and they're all moving around and talking about this marathon. Isn't this great? And there's a whole movie industry about it, entertainment industry, there's a news industry about it. There's the reporters are everywhere now. You know, wow, now so what are you dressed up as? What do you think your time is going to be on this marathon? How do you see yourself running this race? And, you know, giving all sorts of constant, you know, the whole television stations that arise around it. And then people are so engrossed in this, then no one ever gets started. You know, they're so engrossed in this, like, wow, I've got a whole network. I'm building this television network, you know, around this thing. Wow, my gosh, I'm holding interviews with all these people, entertainers. I can put on all this content and all this program, super programming. So this is really interesting. People are really interested in this. Yeah, so we have a whole world's really interested. They say, we're really interested in this marathon, for sure. And they think, well, those people out there running it, what, they're missing all this intensity here, you know, wow, they're missing out on it. Yeah, there's a few people trudging along, you know, just, you know, no one pays them any attention or anything. And back at the start line, there's all sorts of people getting all sorts of attention. You know, who are you? What's your name? Oh, wonderful. Can we have it on our show tonight? We're looking for people who really represent the right attitude, the right spirit to run this race. And come on, the big show. We've got a big television show tonight, and we want to have you as our guest. Oh, wow, really? Yeah. So tell me, how did you get interested in running this marathon? Well, I heard some people were also interested, and I got into that. Great. How long have you been preparing to run this marathon? Well, I've been preparing for, you know, like 10 years. Wow, really? What have you been doing to prepare for it? You know, stuff like this. They never start. Nobody gets started. You don't know anything about it until you get started. Because it's the landscape that you pass as you're running is shocking, is staggering your mind, you see. Your mind's not getting staggered at the start line at all. People of this world not having their mind staggered, really. And of course, everybody's getting, you know, the start line. So many people, million, billions, and billions. And then, of course, illnesses happen there. So plagues happen. It's just, oh my God, you know, build some hospitals to take care of this. Oh my gosh, how can we get started? We got this plague going on. And there's some poor people there. Oh my gosh, we've got to help these poor people. I've got to help these poor people. I can't get started yet. Those wars, those conflicts just break out between those at the start line. They say, wait a minute, we want to get started, you know, this time. And you say, you want to get started then. No, well, we want to go first. No, we want to go first. You can go behind us. No, wait a minute. You got to go behind me. So conflicts break out and go for thousands of years, you know. And nobody's getting started, right? This is the world. This is exactly what's happening, actually. Yeah, of course, somebody finished. Nobody pays any attention. But wait, finish? What do you mean? What do you mean? We're working here on getting started here. What do you mean talking about finishing? You know, we're doing everything possible in our power here. And how dare you? How dare you say I need to get started? What do you mean? We got to resolve this. As a matter of fact, we need some adjudication here. There's a lot of conflict, people wanting to go first and second, what order and how fast they're going to go and all this kind of stuff. And a lot of disputes here. People are getting angry at one another. We need to make a whole judicial system to handle all these disagreements and conflict. And you want us to start with, come on, we got to clean this stuff up first. We got to smooth it out. Yeah, we got to smooth all this stuff out first. Come on. You don't expect us to just get started with all this turmoil here and troubles here at the start line, do you? Great, you're crazy. Come on, that's not fair. That's not fair. So there we go. This is the world. Oh yeah, yeah. What do you do? Well, I'm setting up something. I'm gonna teach people about what to expect. I'm gonna teach them this. I'm gonna do this and this and this. And there's classes everywhere. Universities spring up. You know, education. I'm being educated. And so, oh yeah, I'm getting ready. You know, I'm getting ready to start. Remember, the marathon is to have your mind staggered by the good news. So as you go along, you're like, wow, 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 wow. And then adjusting to it. And the will to keep going and the discipline to keep going. This is a discipline, this is a will, this is a commitment, this is a determination, which only arises, that will's only there when you actually start. Starting is what generates the will. You can't get the will if you don't start. So all these people are waiting for the will, you know, and they don't say, well, I just don't have enough will yet, you know, I just don't feel like I need to deal with all this stuff to get some will. No, that's how you avoid it. Because the will comes when you recognize you have no choice but to run. And see, the reason why everybody's delaying is they think they have a choice. They don't have a choice. They believe they got a choice, and they're saying, you know, my life isn't that bad. I don't really want to put myself through this ordeal and stuff. So I probably, you know, if I just live a good enough life, maybe I'll get into heaven and everything will be fine. I don't have to worry about this stuff. I'll never have to run it. So maybe I get an exception. Maybe I get an exemption. You know, if I have lead a good, righteous life, I'll get an exemption. So they build religions around this at the beginning line. You know, here's a religion that says, you know what? If you just do this and this and this and this and this, that's going to earn an exemption. You're going to get into heaven. You'll be happy forever after. You don't have to worry about running this race at all. And everybody says, wow. A lot of people say, I like that. I like that. I like that. I'm going to join that. Join that. This is the world. This is the world. This is the world. And a lot of people think they're real smart. You know, they say, I think I got this race all figured out, you know. And so I don't really need to run it. I just figured it all out. Again, it's all about moving your comfort zone. The whole marathon is a marathon of moving your comfort zone because we have a continuity fear. The continuity fear cannot be dismissed through intellectual figuring it out. Cannot. It's impossible. Don't get anywhere that way. Now you can set up shop. You can set up shop at the start line, set up shop, and tell people about how much you know about the race and stuff, but yeah, it doesn't, you cannot resolve the continuity fear that way. Have to run the race, have to move your comfort zone, move the comfort zone bit by bit by bit by bit. And many are trying to figure out, how can I run it faster? I mean, I want to do a whole bunch of stuff with my life. So maybe I can run it like in a year or two or something. And so they try to keep figuring out how to do it, and they never get started. You know, they end their life. They spent their whole lives trying to avoid it, thinking like, well, I couldn't quite figure out how to run it fast enough, and I had a bunch of other stuff I needed to do. So hopefully I'll get lucky. Get an exemption because I live the good life. So, this is the situation that the world is. This is the way the world is. It's the way it's always been. It's the way it's always been. So it's super important to listen to a teaching that is adamant. I've been fortunate enough to have teachers like that. So it's rubbed off on me. And I said, yeah, adamant, adamant, adamant. How does one, you know, step into this instant? It's not a step, it's a leap. A leap is different than a step. So what we're conveying here is something different than a step. For the leap is actually permanent. The leap is simply letting go of the steps. A leap is letting go of the steps. But you're not going to do that until you've evaporated this continuity issue, continuity fear, to a large extent. That's why the marathon has to be run. It's a marathon of evaporating your continuity fear, of staggering your mind with the good news bit by bit by bit. And then you keep bouncing back. It's tough. Very tough. It can take a long time. Absolutely it can. It's a marathon. Spiritual path is a marathon. And usually, again, it's people whose lives seem to be ruined from the very beginning that actually do it. Or like someone like St. Francis, you know, young man living in luxury and everything he could possibly want, and then just realizing, this isn't going to satisfy me. And, you know, there isn't anything else as far as riches and everything go. I've had it all. And I could tell this is just going to bore me out of my mind. This is just hideous. I can't stand it. I cannot do it. And just forget it. Leave it all behind. That's you know, a way that happens sometimes. Rich people just say, you know, or well-to-do people, rich people, various types of people, they can reach a point where they say, I just cannot keep doing this. I just it's going to bore me out of my mind. I'm going to waste my life. It's too hideous to even contemplate. And they just say, okay, that's it. I can't. Gotta let it go. And there's that. There's others whose physical health and strength fails them. And they realize that I'll never be able to keep up. I couldn't keep up with the pace of society and change and culture and work. And I couldn't keep up at all. And I realized I fell so far behind. There's no way I'm going to catch up. Ever. It's not possible. And it's true, I've never been able to catch up. So I just said, well, I better find a way, an alternative to this world. I better find an alternative because I'm not going to be able to catch up. And then, of course, all this technology came in, which I don't understand at all as far as, you know, programming and everything about it. I don't have a clue. And I'll never catch up to them, to what they, you know, how these people who are really adept at it see, you know, function and see and all stuff. I cannot catch up to that. I'll always be, you know, way back in their dust. So I just said, forget it. I'm not going to even compete with that. I'm not going to even try to keep up. I'm going to try to shift into some other situation. So I'm really not in competition with, what was that? That was like a spider or something. I'm not in competition with the world, really. Not really. I don't care. Whatever the world does doesn't really relate to me very much at all. Doesn't have anything to do with my future at all, actually. So I sort of, you know, shifted the future, say that my future has nothing to do with this world. Nothing to do with it whatsoever. Nothing to do with bodies, actually, at all. Nothing to do with bodies. Ultimately, there may be an intermediate step of some sort, but ultimately, nothing to do with bodies. And ultimately, nothing even to do with places or things, time, space, form, process, nothing to do with any of that. Certainly, nothing to do with death, nothing to do with sickness, nothing to do with ultimately with words. So it doesn't really matter what the world does exactly, because it's I don't have any interest in the future, this future of all this stuff. So you can do it that way. You can do it. You just get so tired of this world. You say, I just can't keep going on with this. I'm tired of it. Do it that way. You lose your ambition. You lose your drive. You know, and you start falling behind. And that happens. You know, eventually, it will happen to everyone. Eventually, it will happen to everyone. Where you can't keep up anymore. You just because you don't, you're not that interested anymore. You've been burned so many times, you just say, wait a minute. Instead of continue to leap into the fray or you know, forge ahead, you just say, whoa, wait a minute. I forged so many times like this, and I've gotten burned so terribly. Whoa, wait a minute. And you hesitate. And before you know it, you know, the world's passed you by, and you realize you can't even catch up. Now, this happens to a lot of people, and some don't get into the marathon, you know, right away, and they get depressed and they take antidepressants and there's, you know, they struggle with this because they're not quite ready. They say, no, maybe I can avoid the ordeal of the marathon. And that's a tough spot to be in. Many people are in that situation, so they may not start until maybe the next life. They may try to figure some compromise out or something, you know, but that doesn't work. It doesn't work. And when you really drop out in some way and you just lose touch with the world, you can't keep up, you just can't really, then you realize, wow, I have to find an alternative. Have to find an alternative. And then that's when you get, you know, real serious and you start running this marathon. And the marathon is all about one stride at a time. And you gradually move through this mental landscape, as it were, of clarity, of more and more clarity. And good news. Like you look here and you say, wow, I think I see really good news. Oh, look at that there. Wow. And the wow tends to stagger the mind so much that you feel like, oh, wow, I need to slow down. Maybe I should stop. No, you got to finish. You have to keep going. Like, yeah, last night staggered my mind so bad I could hardly sleep. Had a terrible morning, a very difficult day because my mind was trying to stabilize itself. It was so staggered and shocked by the great good news that I saw. So the marathon means, you know, even though you feel like tired, you keep going, you don't stop, you keep the momentum going. You don't set up shop, you keep going. Stay humble. I'm not setting up shop here. And what I'm doing is sharing the experience so people can be reassured. Say, yeah, I got it. Okay, what I'm doing is similar. You know, I just keep going like that. Reassurance. Give me an example. Now, once you take the leap of faith, I don't know then what one would do. I really don't know. I do not know anything, as a matter of fact. I do not know anything. So, I put tremendous amount of stock in Jesus' approach. I really do. But, you know, I'm not going to be dogmatic and say everybody has to, you know, put all their stock in this approach. You know, they don't. There are other compassionate approaches, for sure. And so, All of that is good. I mean, we're not going to sit here and argue over whose approach is the best. That's a game that those who are not getting started play, right? It's like as Jill and I argue, who's the best guitar player, you know? They'll spend like, some of them spend, when I start an argument, just get on some YouTube video and just say, hey, this guitar player is the number one greatest guitar player in history. Nobody else can even touch them. It's obvious. Oh, man, you know. And then they'll, you know, they get serious. They get like chokeholds on each other. They're so upset. So we're not going to do that. Jesus doesn't do that. He says, hey, there's lots of approaches. This is just one. Okay. If you like it, go for it. If you don't, that's fine too. God still loves you. Don't worry about it. So, yeah. And so you have those at the start line are saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, we're going to run the race this way. We want to make sure everybody else runs the race this way. And we're not going to get started until we get everybody to agree that they're going to run the race this way, you know. And then there's all these fights and wars and arguments about that, you know. Nobody gets started running the race, right? So like when I got started, it was out of sheer desperation. I didn't care about anything else except I said, I got to get rid of this suffering. I got to find the answer. I have to find the secret to existence. I have to. So, nothing else mattered. It's all moot point. All this stuff at the start line. Don't have any time for it. Forget it. And of course, it's difficult as you start. You get all this stuff pulling at you. People are yelling at you. Say, hey, what you doing? You know. So try to just not let anybody know at all. But you feel like you're some kind of terrible renegade because you know you're not participating in all this hubbub at the start line. Like, who am I to get started? All these dignitaries haven't been gotten started. All these superstars, all these, you know, none of them got started. Who am I to get started? I'm nobody. Yeah. But it helped. It helped me that I was sort of a, you know, I don't know what you call it, well-known in a previous life. I had a very high station in life. And I was kind of like a celebrity or something like that. So I kind of, and I hung out with the top level of society. And so, you know, them telling me, hey, you can't start, I don't care. I don't care what anyone says like that. I don't care. When you live with these people and you know them and you hang out with them, then the mystique wears off. See, the mystique wears off of all the superstars, the entertainers, the tycoons, you know, the politicians, all these people that I hung out with and rubbed elbows with in my life. You know, it's like, I don't care what, you know, they're not going to tell me what to do. And so as they get started, I think that may have helped a little bit. And plus, I knew celebrity. It's terrible. It's horrible. So I don't want to waste my life trying to be one of these big shots at the start line. You know, forget it. Forget it. It's a pain. It's not much fun at all, actually. Everybody, you know, can I take my picture with you? Can I take a picture with you? Can you give me an autograph? Can you give me an autograph? Can you give me an autograph? Oh, can you help me out? Can you help me? Can you help me? I've got a son or a daughter. Can you give them some advice? You know, it's just nonstop stuff. Like, and it's just like, wow. I got to sign. And the people just want to sign your autograph. They want a piece of you. You know, they want to, can you give me something? Can you sign a picture? Can you do this? That's not a lot of fun. That's why some of them become recluses. Recluses, like, right. A lot of them do, actually. A lot of drives them crazy. You know, just stay away. I want to be alone. You know, just go into hiding. Eventually, it gets to older age. You say, wow, this isn't so much fun anymore. This is the millionth, 10 millionth time, you know, and people are still trying to track me down where I live. And hey, you know. We want something from you, and can you give a blessing for our child? Can you bless our marriage? And can you, you know, it's on and on and on and on and on and on. Basically, these people don't want to get started either, and you give them a good excuse not to, and they kind of hold you in that role. So I didn't want that role at all. I said I just want to be a nobody from nowhere, anonymous nobody from nowhere, and. And again, the idea that somebody was going to tell me I couldn't do this is nobody's going to tell me. Not even the Pope, all right? Not even anybody, not even the President, not the Pope. Forget it. Forget it. They're not telling me anything, what I can do. So, just said I got to get started. Now, and again, nobody's going to tell me who I can listen to, who I can pay attention to. Nobody's going to tell me, well, you can only listen to Jesus here and not here or whatever. I'm going to read whatever book I want to read. And nobody's going to tell me otherwise. So that's the attitude I had. I was sick of all the high society stuff and all that stuff. That's kind of scary too, because you know that doesn't satisfy. And also, you don't want to be some lowly person in the world, laborer, you know. You don't want to dig ditches. And you realize nothing satisfies here. That is very scary. Very scary. There's nothing that I can do in this world. This world doesn't hold any value for me whatsoever. And then you say, oh my God, I get depressed. Well, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Well, thankfully, Dr. Jesus showed up with A Course in Miracles and says, hey, consider this. You know, here's some ideas for you. Here's some help for you. Oh, okay. And other stuff, I was reading a lot of other stuff too before that. And you know, just trying to say, who could be really helpful, really helpful, really helpful. But it has to be done in a mood of really desperation, I would say. It's not some elective, it's not like a hobby. Well, you know, I'll just have this kind of hobby, I enjoy this a little bit or something like that. Those who do it half-heartedly remain in dualism. You're not going to get to this leap of faith. You're not going to get to it. So desperation can be a good thing. I'm desperate right now. I got so much trouble with the future in this world. It's like, wow, what do I have to do? I've got to make some sort of leap of faith, and I'm trying to get the nerve to do it. I've done it before in some way, and I had experience. I had some experiences, and it has to be done in even a greater way now. So all the teaching is only to bring you to no explanation. See, all the explanations are just to bring you to no explanation, where you leap into no explanation. I don't know. You leap into I don't know with no explanation. So you might say, wow, that's difficult. Absolutely. It's difficult. But as Jesus says over and over, he says, listen to my words and let them seep into you, and keep trying to feel beyond them, which I haven't done a very good job, but I've done some. Maybe I just seem to be very feeble. But he says, gradually it will permeate, which is true. And so you can't get frustrated. He says, try to feel beyond it. And he says, I can't really feel anything. And, oh, maybe I should quit. No, you can't quit. Keep working with the words. Keep, as I say, bringing yourself to the burn. See, the burn is beyond the words. Bring yourself to the reverberation and the burn, where you're feeling something that is just beyond words. It's just, wow. Mind is staggered here. And at least experience that, full stop in experiencing that. And this is, then you get comfortable with that intensity, you see, of really intensity of willing to leap, willing to make a leap of faith. The mind wants to make this leap of faith, but has a continuity fear. So it's jittery about it. More and more and more and more and more become less and less jittery, less and less jittery as we do this. Because we try to make little mini leaps, like I'm going to leap into, I don't know. I don't know anything. We use the words, I don't know anything, full stop. I don't know what I am, full stop. I don't know where I am. I do not know where I am. I do not know where I am. So Jesus exhorts us over and over and over and over and over. Don't get stuck on trying to analyze it or figure it out. This is why I bring in this, the fourth phase, full stop in the burn. Do not try to analyze. Do not try to label. Do not try to figure it out. Don't look for exemptions or exceptions. Don't, no residue. Say there's no residue to this whatsoever. None. Just, I do not know where I am. And we're saying this in a super positive way, okay? It's, remember this fourth phase teaching. So, it like phase one, you may not say that. People say, well, you have amnesia or something? What are you talking about? But fourth phase, we understand, I do not know where I am is a very positive spiritual statement, because what we are is. There's not even a where to it. So I do not know where I am. Try to sort of leap into that or float into that. Because maybe it's not even a leap. Maybe it just you float. You just kind of float into it, as it were. Just you go start floating. I do not know where I am. I do not know what I am. Because there's no what. There's no where. There's no what. I do not know anything. There is no anything to know. There's no thingness to know. There's no awareness to know. There's no whatness to know. So as we get used to this little, just sort of little mini testing our wings a little bit, fluttering, maybe we flutter a little bit, everybody's kind of got off the ground a little bit, that gradually calms our nerves down so we can stretch our wings. Jesus puts it as we say, I do not know. He says, you're stretching your wings out like this and you're getting ready to fly, and you're stretching your wings out into realization of truth. So I do not know. I do not know. Period. I do not know. I do not know. For example, just from yesterday, this is bringing about much less of a burn than yesterday. Much less, my mind is already, gotten used to this. So this does not stagger the mind. It's not staggering my mind. Whereas yesterday was staggering my mind. Today, no. So it shows you do make progress from day to day. Not that it's easy. When you stagger your mind, you're going to, going to experience some backlash from that. You may try to listen to a bunch of music or eat a lot of food, some way to kind of make you feel good and distract yourself from it. So you may get into distraction. I was singing a song all day. I was fighting against this song. I was trying to replace it with something else. It was just like an endless loop. You might get into the endless loop of song. imagining scripts, movie scripts, stories, all sorts of daydreams and things. This is what you have to struggle against. And sometimes you just have to fight it to a standstill. You may not win so easily. I did say, like, leap of faith, or I do not know, I do not know. I do not know. The loop would keep playing. I said, no, I do not know. I do not know. No residue. No explanation. Full stop, no explanation. And kept battling all day like this. So you run into some headwinds on the marathon, and you know, you just have to keep, don't let it push you back too much. Keep going, and eventually the headwinds will soften, and you're able to then run forward more easily. So it's an ordeal, but when you really realize your life is just ruined, you know, you're not going to have a happy life, then you might as well get started. I figure I'm not going to have a happy life anyway. I might as well give a reason to be miserable by going through this ordeal. At least I can point back and redeem, you know, my efforts, because, you know, it's time well effort, time well spent. So I don't feel bad about it. I use my time fabulously well. But it hasn't been happy times, that's for sure. It's been misery. But misery redeemed. The progress of today redeems the misery of yesterday. The battle that I fought yesterday shows up in the progress of today. So it's like that. People who, you know, love their lives and everything's happy and they think it's comfortable and prosperous and stuff, they look at it as like some kind of accessory, like some diamond necklace or something. Like, hey, I like to have some kind of really nice accessories. Everybody think that I ran the marathon or something. Can you give me something symbolizes it? You know, I can accessorize myself that way. They're not going to cast aside the good times. But if you're miserable and depressed and all that stuff, that's actually very helpful. It can be very helpful. So all you need to do is get more and more serious, more and more serious, more and more serious, which is, you know, it's not easy in this day and age where everybody's just posing, you know, at the start line, and not many are running. Not many are really running. Because for, like, in my case, I saw the finish line. I saw what's going to happen, and I said, "Oh wow, I got to get there somehow." And the good news was so great, you know, staggered me, totally staggered me. And I say, "How do I wear away this, you know, being of continuity fear here?" And the answer of the Holy Spirit was, "You just have to work at it day by day. There's no other way." So, yeah, this world can be a very terrible place. And the worst situation is when you just can't deal with the world, and yet you don't start the spiritual marathon. That's the worst. That is the worst. I remember those times. I thought I could just learn a whole bunch about spirituality, become a spiritual intellectual, and do it that way. And I found out I can't do it that way. Then I said, wow, I mean, I actually have to take the path and actually do it? Yeah, I actually have to do it. So I thought I could just know a whole bunch about others that had done it and tell other people about it and stuff and tell stories. No, I actually have to do it myself. I said, wow. And that's the same for everybody. No exceptions, no exemptions. So those who are actually going through this ordeal feel like they're in a hurricane. You know, it's just. Or on some life raft on the middle of some stormy ocean. And they're just hoping the life raft finds its way to land and they can hold on. So. It's like life or death. Now, I talk about sitting quietly, sitting in one place, sitting still, sitting quietly, not getting up, not interrupting. It's very important, very helpful. And what I say is really, I'm speaking to the ones who have actually started now, because they're the ones I'm speaking to, actually, mostly, for the most part. They're the ones, only ones who really listen and really hear what's being said. And you should look at your sitting quietly like this, which it means gives you the opportunity to have your mind staggered by great good news, which is what you have to do. Because the news at the end of the finish line is so incredibly wonderful that you have to get stagger your mind bit by bit by bit by bit so you can finally accept it. You should sit in as if getting up is death to you. It's death to you. You feel like, if I get up, I'm going to die. It should be that kind of dedication. Now, many have practiced this in many different ways in the past. And, sometimes people would meditate and hang out and live in a graveyard with all the different stuff that goes on there. And they wouldn't stop their meditation. You know, they'd practice, I'm not breaking my meditation for any reason whatsoever, sitting here quietly. And you can even practice this. I did this today. If all these different temptations that come to you to break your meditation. And you can try it yourself. Someone says you just won the lottery, but you need to call in 10 minutes. You need to call this number in 10 minutes. You say, if I get up to make this call, I'm going to die. Your new lover calls you and says, you just need to meet me here in 20 minutes. And you say, if I get up from this, I'm going to die. So no way. Someone says, you know, I love you, I'm going to marry you. Are you kidding? You're the love of my life. If you get up from sitting quietly, you're going to die. So I said, no. My guru said, if I get up, I'm going to die. So the intensity should be like that. This is what the gurus, adamant gurus, tell us. Is you have to feel your practice is if you don't practice, you're going to die. And of course, what really is worse than that, you're going to lose your momentum. That's even worse than death. Because losing momentum, you're sliding back down into innumerable deaths, along with sickness and suffering and misery, etc. So it's worse than dying, actually. It's way worse. Way worse. So the world will throw all sorts of stuff at you. Hey, could you help me out? Damsel in distress. Say, no, my guru told me if I get up, I'm going to die. Worse than death for me. Can you find my lost child? Can you find my lost cat? Can you help out? No, if I get up, I'm going to suffer worse than death. Oh, you're crazy. Yeah. All you have to do to not be crazy is to get up. Say, no, if I get up, it's worse than death for me. So you just have to have this attitude. To break your meditation is worse than death. So this is the seriousness that we're talking about on this marathon. The seriousness is, I have to keep going on this, because if I don't, it's worse than death, way worse. I was thinking someone may ask me today, "Oh, you look like you know the secret of life. Can you tell me?" I said, "Well, I can tell you, but you're going to hate me for, you know." So it was just the answer is, I don't know. That is the secret. The secret to freedom from existence, the secret everyone's looking for, and the last place that anyone would ever look for it. Someone says, "What is the answer to the problems of life and suffering?" And the answer is, "I don't know." That's the answer. But it's a positive "I don't know." I don't know anything at all. There's nothing to know. There's no answers to know whatsoever. That's the answer. Because we're spirit, we're free. We're not a body, we're spirit, we're free. As God created us to be. That's the last place anyone would ever look for it. So, you know, telling someone that, they're going to think you're crazy. You're trying to just pulling their leg. Trying to fool them, you know. So it's like that. So I said, "Okay, I'll tell you what. What you got to do first is you have to sit there. Okay, just sit there and don't move. Don't get up. Don't get up. And I'll come back a little while. Yeah, first you have to show that you're capable of understanding what I have to tell you. And so you come back a little while, see if they're still sitting, and say, "Okay, well, that was pretty good. But now I want you to sit there a little longer and come back later." This is a spin on the classic tale that you know, historically has been said many times, is the teacher says, "Sure, I'll tell you the truth, but first you need to sit quietly." And then what happens is somebody comes along and says, "Hey, boss, you know, new client here, didn't meet them. Oh my gosh, I gotta go meet them." And they get up, you know. And the guru comes back and says, "What happened?" He says, and "I had to get up, I had to talk to him." "Well, I can't tell you this, the secret, the answer then. You have to start again, start over, sit." So in this way, you gradually get used to more and more sitting without getting up for any reason whatsoever. It's very important. Worse than death, way worse than death. "Hey, someone just died, you need to attend their funeral or something." No, can't. Now, we're just using as examples, but this is the idea. "Hey, it looks like the world is ending, you gotta get up." No, my guru said, worse than the world ending if you get up. I think this is something that great meditators have told us, that they get all these temptations to break their meditation, their deep meditation. All these temptations. "Hey, you just been elected, you know, queen of the world, queen of the universe, but we need to put the crown on your head. You need to come on over here." No. No. My guru said, if I get up, it's worse than death, way worse. If I move, so. So these are the temptations. Absolutely, you run into those. So most importantly, even if you don't want to listen to anybody, keep practicing more and more, sitting quietly like this, because this will automatically enable your mind to be staggered by the good news, and you will have insights that arise automatically from within you, suddenly clarifying. It's like, wow, I see this, I see this stumbling block, and now I won't stumble on it anymore. And it's, wow, tremendous good news. And it will stagger your mind for sure. And yet here you can just sit quietly like this and let the mind, let the dust settle. This is the secret of success. I mean, I've got my mind so absent-minded, you know, that I'm not even paying any attention to the world whatsoever. I have no idea what's going on. Trying to see what's going on in the mind. And you really forget all about the world, so you become very absent-minded. If you're trying to function, you might seem to be very absent-minded. People say, what's wrong with you? So it's better to sit quietly and let this burn, just sit in the burn and let it eventually cool off, let it all burn down like a fire that turns into ashes, smoldering, then it's out. And you say, okay, fire is now out. So light a fire every day in your mind of good news. I don't know anything. I don't know what I am. I don't know where I am. I don't know anything. I don't know what I am. I don't know where I am. I don't know anything. I do not know. Period. I do not know. I do not know. I do not know. So I keep making these videos just to keep reinforcing, and for my own practice also. Because we do have to make this leap of faith, leap into I do not know. Because we're coming up in this crossroads, very much so, where there's a lot of pressure on you to tell you that you do know, or you're supposed to know. And that's, you know, that is going to cause a great deal of delay. So we'll keep working on this leap of faith into, I do not know, I do not know, I do not know, I do not know, I do not know. I do not know what I am, I don't know where I am, I do not know, I do not know. Let this be a mantra, I do not know. Okay. Very great. That's it for this one.